Marx. A fire and Engels came to the checkout at the 7-Eleven. Marx was good, but he had sense. Engels, Lenin, the necessary events.
Hi, my name is Cam Hardy. I'm the Toronto organizer of the Platypus Affiliated Society. We've just started up on the U of T campus, meeting every Thursday for a reading group. The question of Marx's return has kind of been in the mainstream press and been mentioned a lot in light of the economic crisis. And you know, you can tell it's become a concern when whether the National Post or the head of the Church of England or whoever are referencing Karl Marx. It makes you wonder if, you know, a familiar specter is yet again haunting the Western world. But on the other hand, with this renewed interest, there's also the fact that right now is one of the lowest points ever in terms of labor action, strikes. Even the mainstream left, which usually does well during economic crisis, can't seem to make a breakthrough, let alone the radical left, who joined the civic side earlier. So with that in mind, it's worth thinking about and interrogating the question of whether Marx is back and what his return means and the implications that this holds for us. So that's what we're going to be talking about tonight. Just like to introduce our speakers. From the Platypus Society, we have Ian Morrison, who's an editor of the Review and from Chicago, and he writes for the Tehran Bureau. And also Professor Panitch, she's the Canada Research Chair in Comparative Political Economy and distinguished research professor of political science at York University, and co-editor of the annual Socialist Register. He's the author of Renewing Socialism, which you can see is on sale. The good market sales plug there. And with that covered, why don't we begin?
So I'm going to sort of get things wrong with a little statement I worked up. So Platypus is interested in regression. I don't mean this simply in a pessimistic sense, but instead in the sense of repetition. There have been countless returns to Marx's work throughout the 20th century and now in the 21st. Why return to Marx yet again? What does this move tell us about our contemporary situation? And perhaps most important for us tonight, what do previous returns to Marx tell us about capitalism and those who have self-consciously struggled against it? I want to propose that the way various political actors have returned to Marx tell us a great deal about what it means to be anti-capitalist and how this has been subject to change. But understanding anti-capitalist politics as competing and overlapping imaginations about what is at stake in Marx's work and what capitalism even is, I think we can, from that start, easily dispense with some of the typical criticisms leveled at Marx, particularly the commonly held view that Marxism proposes a teleological or linear account of history, by which capitalism is inevitably moving towards a great crisis, after which the working class will inevitably inherit the earth. For this purpose of our discussion tonight, I'd like to propose that through analysis of conflicting imaginations, we can develop at least a preliminary account of what's possible today. We commonly break modern history into periods, from the Victorian capitalism of Marx's era to what is often referred to as state Fordist capitalism, and then to the neoliberal capitalism of the present. Implicit in such a periodization is the recognition that something remains constant through all of these stages, namely capitalism. This is why we've returned to Marx. Something essential remains. But as much as capitalism is constant, it is also ceaselessly dynamic, and painfully so. Our ability to grasp what is essential, the capitalism remains throughout these periods, is always melting in the air, and hence this repetition. To be clear, Platypus as a project is premised on a return to Marx, but we want to make sure that we are fully cognizant of what that entails. Marxism as a tradition is effectively defined by these returns. The radicalism of the Second International often understood themselves as recovering Marx from revisionist or vulgarizers. Anti-Stalinists from Trotsky to the Frankfurt School had a similar self-conception in the interwar period. And the New Left had its own rather complicated return to Marx. These overlapping imaginations demand clarification. And this year marks the 50th anniversary of the founding of the New Left Review. And I think it's fair to say that during the last half century, that the whole New Left project has lapsed. Although they're still influential, post-structuralism and post-modernist critiques more generally seem increasingly inadequate in the face of recent historical transformations. In addition, the complete disappearance of the anti-war movement, concurrent with the economic crisis, is precipitating a return to Marx now. However, what Marx will become in the process of this return to Marx is not yet apparent. We're forced into, I think, a contemplative posture in the absence of a left today, and understanding the slow collapse of the left over time becomes a necessary step for the reconstitution of a new left. So, with that in mind, I wanted to start just with sort of a basic question about why you returned to Marx's works when you did, and what was at stake for you.
I didn't return. When I was an undergraduate student and read the preface to the Critique of Political Economy, I whispered to my fellow student, a close friend, he still is today, his comrade Sam Gindin. We were doing Latin and economics classes together. I think I'm a Marxist. In some general sense, I think that that came to be confirmed both intellectually and politically in subsequent years and decades. So I don't feel that I've returned. In my case, it fit in the sense of that I came out of a working class milieu in North Winnipeg, out of a social democratic, in the Canadian case, CCF, NDP kind of heritage, trade union background that my parents had, with arguments when I was a boy between my aunt, who had been a communist in the 30s, and my father, who was a social democrat, over the Hitler-Stalin pact. I was born in 1945, the Hitler-Stalin pact was in 1939-40, but that remained a bone of contention over a dinner table. I think conversations is not the right word, a dinner table. Vicious argument. And so, in some ways, this was something that was not alien to the culture of North Winnipeg. And in becoming or thinking of myself as a Marxist, I suppose it was part of the New Left. But that part of the New Left, which was oriented to attempting to recover a working class party political project, which learned the lessons of the mistakes and defeats of both communist parties, Leninist parties, when I say that, and in which I include Trotsky's parties. I've never been a member of any of those Marxist-Leninist groups, as well as the mistakes of what has been the majority working-class socialist movement in capitalist history, which is labor parties and social democratic parties. Most workers have never associated themselves with Marxist ideological parties. They've associated themselves with, or Leninist Marxist parties, with social democratic parties. So for me, it wasn't a return. Mm-hmm. Now, that said, a lot of Marxist economists would not consider me a Marxist. Mm-hmm. I've never been particularly attracted to value theory in the sense that the only surplus is produced by workers in a narrow industrial sense of industrial workers. Mm-hmm. I have never put much store in the falling rate of profit as an explanation of capitalist crises. I was always critical of the Leninist form of organization. So I guess I was the type of Marxist that would not have been ever considered a Marxist by the people who were selling materials outside the door. I came to describe myself as a Marxist or felt comfortable in being so described, I think by virtue of an identification with the revolutionary project in the sense of the need for a project to transcend capitalism. I think what attracted me to it intellectually was how much it explained about the dynamic and competitive nature of capitalism. That involved rejecting a lot of Marxism, which saw capitalism as monopoly capitalism. In my view, the bourgeoisie remains the most revolutionary class. And the revolutionary task is to try to build a class that can be more revolutionary than the bourgeoisie. It remains the most revolutionary class today. As you read that in the manifesto, the bourgeoisie is the most revolutionary class in history. It recreates the world in its own image, etc. The capitalist classes continue to do this right to up to our time. The working classes, in that sense, has failed to be revolutionary or learned to become revolutionary. Whether it can is something that history will only write with our own efforts and efforts of generations to follow. But I was going to say, above all, I think what made me a Marxist was understanding, I think, that Marxism gave, as it developed, especially through the 1960s and 70s, to the understanding it gave to the behavior and nature of the capitalist state. That is, whereas social democrats, liberals, saw the state in terms of reining in the market, in terms of limiting the excesses of capitalism, as being something that stands outside of capitalism, which in a democracy we can attempt to somehow influence to limit capitalism, to make it more just, more humane. What Marxism seemed to provide to me was a key to understanding, not that Marx figured it out himself, but I think laid the basis for figuring it out, for understanding that the state is primarily, because of its own dependence on capital accumulation, because of the way that it's structured consistently with capitalism, it is primarily oriented to facilitating accumulation, to defending private property, to reproducing class relations. And the notion that one captures the state in order to limit capitalism, to improve capitalism, rather than understand that the state is an incubator for, even when it does reforms, for the reproduction of capitalism, for its greater dynamism, is the key to, I think, avoiding a politics that can't get you out of capitalism. All the more so in terms of those who, understand capitalism as being something that is about doing away with the state. As neoliberals do, or as you learn in neoclassical economics in your courses, that markets operate free of states, they operate more efficiently if there aren't states, etc. This is the greatest voodoo that is taught to undergraduate students in economics department. So that's the sense in which I was always a Marxist. I've never returned to it because, since I was a teenager, I guess, a late teenager, that's how I saw myself. But I saw myself as a Marxist in terms of all of its limitations, intellectual, social scientific, and certainly political. The task, it seems to me, and we've only made small inroads, I think, in my generation, is to develop the type of Marxism which is constantly developing itself intellectually, but is capable of contributing to the building of the kind of class that is revolutionary. My generation has failed, not in the sense, not intellectually, I think it's made a lot of contributions intellectually, especially in terms of the theory of the state. It's failed, I think, to connect, to build the kind of organizational vehicles that can make ordinary people comfortable with themselves as intellectuals, comfortable with themselves as understanding the world without having to listen to a professor tell them this is how the world works, comfortable with themselves in terms of, yeah, I can understand how this system is operating and can join together with other people in using that understanding to get beyond the system. For that, you need political organization. And my generation hasn't created the successive political organizations of the Communist parties, the Trotskyist parties, etc., or the Second International parties to be able to do that. That's long-winded, but I think that's...
Is it fair to say then, Chris, that that's how you see yourself as breaking with the old left, was in the sense that you're sort of in the 60s and the 70s too, there was not like a party model that was used at all. And there was also, it seems, I think what's unique about your work, it was very much like a farewell to the working class perspective that more 60s and 70s adopted, but that it's fair to say that was never really a part of your...
I don't think that became very common until the 80s. I mean, there's an element of the new left in the States which was not linked very much to the labor movement, partly because they were alienated by virtue of so much of the labor movement's support for the Vietnam War. I think most of my generation embraced a rather romantic notion of the working class by virtue of its trade union militancy in the 1960s and the 70s. And in rejecting social democracy and the Soviet-aligned communist parties, they didn't reject Leninism and searched for a more authentic Leninism, especially via Trotsky's party. Or, in a rather romantic way, took up Maoism as a version of Marxism-Leninism that was more third-worldist, more peasant-oriented, etc. I don't think it was until the 80s, with post-structuralism, post-modernism, with the defeat of that working class militancy of the 60s and 70s, that you got to turn away from a working class politics. I think most of the new left, certainly in Canada and in Europe, would have not seen itself that way until the 80s.
I guess people often use sort of the dates 1968 and then also 1973 as sort of touchstones, and one is like a political date, one is an economic date, and I think today when you look back at those two in combination, it's confusing in the sense that 1968 seems like a kind of romantic outburst of revolution, but then also it seems like there's really a waning of reform politics that's taking place at that time. And how are we to sort of make sense of that transition today, I guess?
I 68 represents not only the great anti-Vietnam mobilizations around the world, and not only May 68 in Paris. It also represents Prague. It represents the recognition that not only social democratic reformism had run up against all of the limits of state bureaucracy and reproducing capitalism, but that Soviet-style communism had also passed into history as something progressive. That the attempt to turn it in, which a lot of people, such as Isaac Deutscher, the great Trotskyist, thought that those parties could be democratized. That a new generation of working class activists in them, and intellectuals, could democratize them. And I think with 68, with the invasion of Prague by the Soviets, I think for some people it was already clear from Yugoslavia in 48 and Hungary in 56 and so on, but especially with 68, I think there was a record, I think this defined the new left in a lot of ways, that both capital C communism and capital SD social democracy had passed their historic shelf life as movements of transformation in a positive sense. I think that was what really defined my generation. Some of them rushed off into Trotskyist and Maoist parties. Others tried to build the kind of independent Marxism or socialism that would yield a new non-Leninist type of, nevertheless, class party. And I think we've all failed in the sense of building the successive type of organization. I don't think we failed as much culturally or intellectually, but organizationally, definitely.
But why is it sort of using the 73 turning point that we have this kind of frustrated inability to have reform in politics? I mean, a lot of politics in the U.S., and I'm sure it's the same here, like uses this, celebrates the word resistance as a kind of papering over of the difficulty of having reform politics at all. And I'm wondering sort of what you see as sort of the origins of that difficulty, because, you know, it presents a kind of like where to begin. People often pose it that way, because reform politics are so difficult to even get involved in almost. Whether it's trade unions or the legacies of the new social movements.
Yeah. It was no doubt the case that by 73, I think it was really earlier, people who had, I think very naively, believed that you could win reforms within capitalism and have them pile up one on top of the other, so that at one point you'd realize you had gotten beyond capitalism. By 73, certainly by 75, 76, in the midst of the crisis, it was clear that if you couldn't get beyond those reforms, if you couldn't displace the labor market, not just provide unemployment insurance, but actually get rid of it, if you couldn't have a democratic system of economic planning, which would involve taking the banks into the public sector and making them a democratically run public utility. In other words, if you couldn't plan what was going to be invested, how it was going to be invested, where it was going to be invested, that you would begin to lose the reforms you had won. And that was patently clear in what was known as the crisis of Keynesianism. You know, the vast fiscal crisis of the state, as you had massive state deficits, as full employment produced massive inflation. And you know, there was good reasons for this. I mean, you know, people on the left don't like to admit this, and you get in trouble with trade unions if you said it then. But you know, when I came back to Canada in 1972 from England, nurses were making wage demands of 25, 30, 40%. Why shouldn't they have been? They were just unionizing. They were just organizing. They saw that partly as a matter of, we're doing all of the basic work in the hospitals and look at the difference between us and doctors. But they also saw it in terms of the fact that industrial workers were now earning more than nurses were. Well, a 40% wage demand is a revolutionary demand. It can't be met unless it causes inflation. But this had been going on amongst young workers, both public and private sector workers, since full employment was reached for the first time, really, after the war in the 1960s. It was my generation, you know, you went to work. And you realized that by the time you were 25, 26, you'd reached the height of what you were going to be able to earn individually. From then on, whatever you were going to get was going to be based on a collective wage increase or salary increase for everyone working in your office or your plant. And with full employment around, you weren't afraid of asking for a very large increase. And even if you weren't at all leftist, you were being pummeled with advertising telling you that the good life depended on owning a car, a radio, a stereo, a refrigerator, a home in the suburb, etc. In that context, with all, you know, the main thing about the reserve army of labor is that it induces fear. Fear of being unemployed. Fear of having the freedom to sleep under the bridges of the Seine. In other words, you know, if you're unemployed, you lose security. Well, workers in the 1960s, if they got fired for collectively asking too much, could go down the street and pick up another job. If their boss told them to work harder, it was not uncommon for a young worker, male or female, to tell them to fuck off, pardon me for the expression, because you knew you could pick up a job very easily down the road. This produced a tremendous amount of militancy, in other words, right? And that caused real, and a lot of people predicted that it would in the 1940s, when people were saying Keynesianism will yield full employment. A lot of people, Joan Robinson, who wasn't a Marxist, Michael Kolesky, who was, were saying this is a fundamental contradiction for capitalism. It can't have full employment. And that was proven in the 1960s, insofar as workers' demands, workers' refusals to work harder, did have inflationary effects or did have the effects of squeezing profits. And that worked itself out in the crisis of the 70s, which I think was a worker-driven crisis. It was a reflection of working class strength. It was also a reflection of the fact that capitalism is always competitive. So, you know, their bosses couldn't raise prices as much as they wanted in light of pressures from below. What the crisis of the 70s showed was that you couldn't pile up reform and get beyond capital. You could fuck capitalism up. You could make it function not very well, right? And given our inability to turn those militant workers into socialists, into revolutionary socialists, the result was, by the end of the 70s, this is why a lot of people turned against the working class, was those workers lost their nerve in the context of the withdrawal from Keynesianism, in the context of the rise of unemployment after the crisis. They got frightened. They got very frightened. The trade unions were subjected to one defeat after another. And the illusions that people had that because you have working class militancy, those people are likely to become revolutionaries without the intervention of ideology, party, etc. People lost that illusion. And you know, could increasingly see the working class not only as not militant, but without a revolutionary agent, often look reactionary vis-a-vis gender, vis-a-vis the ecological crisis, etc.
But it's sort of a question that I think people think about today too is why can't working class demands and the sort of the things we associate with the new social movements coalesce?
And they can, and they often have. In this province, the pro-choice struggle would never have been won without the women who led it winning over the Ontario Federation of Labour. That was critical. And a lot of the 60s generation, some of those who went into the Communist Party, some of those who went into the Trotskyist parties, most of them independent leftists, most of them would have defined themselves as Marxist in the 70s, made their way either into the labour movement or had allies in it and were absolutely crucial to winning the Ontario Federation of Labour support for the right to an abortion. I think it's nevertheless true that it took a long time for trade unions to be open to women's struggle in a much broader sense. And the, you know, the women's movement was the most successful movement by far of the last quarter of the 20th century. Nothing parallels it in terms of mobilization and victories. Right? Socialist feminists have largely been marginalized within that movement. Most of the victories were liberal victories, not to say they weren't important. It took a long time, but if you look at trade unions today, they are transformed from what they were in the 1970s, both in terms of the number of women who are activists in them or leaders in them, and in terms of, even if all of the men don't actually believe it or act like it, in terms of what one is permitted to say at a trade union meeting, the discourse has been transformed, totally transformed. You could do the same also with a range of other types of transformations that have taken place. What has not taken place is the ability to link that with a socialist politics in either the trade union movement or in the women's movement or the ecological. And that is very sorely needed.
What do you see as sort of as the fetters on why that didn't occur?
It's hard. I mean, well, obviously. obviously there is the legacy of the failures of the 20th century. Whereas it was all too easy in the 1930s to take a militant worker or someone in the unemployment marches, point to the Soviet Union, they'd know damn all about what was going on with the show trials, but would see full employment there. And would see it in a positive way, in the sense of being positively aligned with the Spanish Civil War struggles, etc. You could turn such a person into a Marxist. That was much, much harder to do by the 1970s, given the legacy of obviously the enormous Cold War propaganda, but there was plenty of that around in the 20s and 30s as well. It was more a matter of, you know, the objective limits and failures of pointing to a model. There was, and in a sense, I think it's really positive that we've gotten beyond that. I don't know how long this legacy will last, but if you think about it, there was no model before 1917. No one had a model to point to. I don't think we lost very much in 1989 when those regimes finally confirmed that communism was historically passé, which most of us in the 60s already believed. That's not to say I didn't admire people who joined the Communist Party in 1968. They were the people who proved that, you know, this wasn't a lark. They knew when they joined the Communist Party it would be hard to get a job, you were going to be shunned by a lot of your family. It took a lot of commitment. And most of them joined with the hope of democratizing those parties. I mean, I admired most of them, to be fair to them. You know, I thought they'd never do it, and they didn't, the courage involved in that was significant. It took a lot of political courage. And so I think we're better off without the model. And I'm very frustrated, and I was very frustrated by the anti-globalization movement, when people look to the model of Porto Alegre, or now Venezuela, or the Zapatistas. Because they, not that those struggles don't need to be supported, don't need to be encouraged, we don't have to build solidarity with them, but the tendency of people who went down there and looked at them was not to ask hard questions about them. It was much like when Sidney and Beatrice Webb, the great Fabian theorist, went to the Soviet Union in 1935, came back and said, I've seen the future and it works. And I would find, when I went down to the World Social Forum in Porto Alegre every year, that in the same naive kind of way, people would go visit a participatory budget meeting, would listen to some description of it by a Workers' Party bureaucrat, and would come back and say, I've seen the future in the past. And all of the hard questions which should have been asked about the limitations of participatory budgeting, although it was remarkable that uneducated, not informally educated, black women were deciding whether to build a sewer or build a road in their favela, the fact that there would never be a discussion in any of those meetings over the direction of the Workers' Party, over the class struggles that were taking place in Porto Alegre. You know, every time you built a sewer in a favela, the landlord who actually owned that land would say, hey, this land is worth something, and would start demanding of the city either recompense for the land that was occupied, right, or that the demand be given back to him. There was a class struggle going on in Porto Alegre over this. This was never discussed in a participatory budget meeting. What was discussed was, well, we have so many pennies to spend on fixing this up. Which one should we choose? So there wasn't a process of political development. And that's just an example. You could point to similar examples with the Zapatistas, which were mainly a military organization. And a lot of naivete was around on the left, however impressive their struggle was, around this being a perfect form of democracy. All the things we need to figure out of how to have a democratic political organization, which is so hard, people didn't ask those hard questions. So the example, what I'm trying to say is, I think we need to get away from model blaming. The best form of solidarity is to try to go to struggles where they're taking place, movement building where it's taking place, party building where it's taking place, a revolutionary process that's in place, and saying, what are the obstacles that you're facing? What are the things that are proving most difficult? What do you think you're not going to be able to overcome? That's the kind of things we need to learn. So I don't think losing the model was important. Having had that model has been an enormous albatross around our necks in terms of building new organizations. I think it's fading. I really think it is finally going. I think when someone hears that you're a Marxist, hears you're a revolutionary, hears you're a socialist, it's much less likely now that what they hear is that you're going to throw people in jail, into concentration camps, turn the trade unions into ciphers of the party, et cetera, et cetera. I think people don't hear that any longer. And that's very positive.
Yes. Sort of backing up a little bit, given the current economic crisis as something that's been precipitating this return to Marx, there's been a lot of people who have thought about ideas of a new deal. It's something that goes around a lot in American politics, and there's a kind of romantic notion of the welfare state, full employment, and these types of reformist politics that seem difficult to get going today. And yet, the new left was sort of premised on a critique of the welfare state.
Right.
And so, I'm wondering if you could explain how we deal with that shift taking place, and how we, not to be romantic about reforms, and thinking that we can return to this similar situation that the new left found difficult also.
Yeah. This was, for me, the most astonishing development by the early 80s. In face of the crisis of Keynesianism, the defeat of trade unionism, those people who had been most radical in their critiques of reformism turned 180 degrees. My very close friend, Frances Piven, and her husband, Richard Cloward, wrote the book on the way in which welfare politics demobilizes and incorporates poor people, robs them of their radicalism, subordinates them to social workers who are agents of the state, whose job it is to see whether there's an extra toothbrush on the sink, and therefore know that a woman who's on welfare benefits shouldn't be receiving them because there's a guy around, since American welfare benefits, of course, were always premised on single mothers. And Richard and Francis turned 180 degrees, and by the early 80s were offering a fulsome and undialectical critique of the welfare state in the face of Reaganism. The new class war, it was called, it was true, there was a class war from above, it's certainly true, but it was the kind of critique that failed to remember the extent to which the people who need the welfare state, single mothers on welfare, nevertheless were indeed alienated from it, afraid of it, never felt it was theirs to control. All of the things that allowed for the Reaganite and Thatcherite appeal with regard to anti-statism. The same thing happened with Bowles and Gintis, who had done the most radical critique of the educational system. Education was social control, full stop. The working class kids were pulled into the education system. It was about social control. Turned 180 degrees, right? And offered a fulsome defense of welfareism, of Keynesianism. And I think that was it was understandable, because you can't make a revolution overnight. They were trying to hold on to whatever reforms they could. Suddenly they realized these didn't matter. They were real reform, with all of these negative aspects. And therefore offered a very undialectical defense. That is the predominant politics. It hasn't really been social movement politics that's been the predominant politics. Social movement politics was important, women's movements won wonderful victories, but the predominant politics has been still a version of social democratic reformism. You know, whether they're liberals in a hurry or not, which is what Tom Naylor called the NDP, you know, that's been their politics, and it's been very defensive through the last 20, 30 years. And it remains the predominant politics of the left, not the movement politics. The predominant politics is get a piece of the state, push a policy, win a reform, and that's, I mean, that's like, you should, one should introduce that, reforms are necessary. But it has not been capable, one, those reforms have been very constrained, very contained, increasingly compromised with neoliberalism, as we know very well. But secondly, those reforms don't build in a way that gets you past the contradictions of capitalism. Don't, and above all, don't give people the capacities to build on those reforms to get beyond capitalism. And they're the types of reforms that do contain mobilization. So I think you're right to point to this. Now, how does one handle this? You can't win people to a transformative politics without being able to offer them some immediate returns. People need these things. They do need more unemployment insurance. Students do need to stop the rise in student fees. You know, you want to go through the list. Immediate demands are needed. How do you connect that to a politics that has a long-run strategy and understands the limits of those reforms is very, very difficult. Let me give you one example of this dilemma. I don't think it's so insurmountable, but I think it's very difficult. It's so easy to get trapped in the reform and not want to take the risk of building on it. Or calling for the kind of reform which is unlikely to be accepted by the state. You always want to find, you know, you try to want to figure out for the state how they can make it compatible with capitalism, as if they're not smart enough to do it. I was in El Salvador in 1995. The FMLN, the peace process had just been concluded, and the FMLN, which was the revolutionary organization engaged in a 15-year-long civil war, had just turned itself into a political party rather than a military organization. And they invited, I was invited down, it was via some people who had been active in support work, to run their first educational program of the party. They didn't know how to do that. They ran it as though they had just run me. I was a candidate in an election campaign. I was put on the back of a truck with armed guards, since there was still a lot of arms around at the time, and, you know, taken to very large halls where I was expected to educate by giving lectures without simultaneous translation. So I'd say three words, and then there'd be three words in Spanish, and it was an appalling educational process. Except for some great meetings I had with small groups of elected mayors in various villages. At one point during the, I was shepherded around by the woman who was head of the education department, Angela Zamora, whose brother had run for president for a Social Democratic Party, but she'd been in the struggle for 15 years. And she took me to a meeting with the man who had been the head guerrilla, the subcomandante on the San Salvador volcano. We went to dinner. And he said, you know what's wrong with this party and everybody in it? They think the long term is the next presidential election, which would have been 1999. He said, no, that's the short term. We have to hope that by 1999 we are a viable party with a activist base. The middle term is 2010. by which point we have to hope that we are a significant enough political force that we can represent all of the relevant political forces in the country. And the long term is 2020, by which point we could hope that we could enter the state and be actually be able to carry through a transformation. And she, Angela Zamora, turned to him and with tears in her eyes said, in that case, I'm leaving the party. She said, I can't go back to people who have been through a civil war for 15 years and tell them they have to wait until 2020 before anything can happen. And that captures the dilemma. And I don't have an answer for this of an easy kind either. I believe it is possible to build the kind of organization that can win reforms, can be a strong enough organization, and can nevertheless at the same time convince people that those reforms are limited, constrained, likely to be lost, unless revolutionary reforms or structural reforms are won, which is very different than reformism. In other words, the type of nationalization of the banks occurs in when there's a crisis like this that actually allows for democratic planning, that allows for the decision to be made that we're not going to let auto plants with all of the skills, the incredible skills of tool and die makers, all of the equipment, just go down the drain and could be converted into ecologically sustainable uses. Your tool and die makers can virtually make anything. But when you close a parts plant, as is happening all across Ontario, or Ohio or Michigan, you name them, you're losing a whole legacy of skills that has been a collective product. You can't save them unless you can redirect the credit, the capital that passes through the financial system. So the whole essence of being able to do something substantive depends on having a financial system as a public utility, which is part of the democratic planning process. I think people can be brought to understand this and can demand reforms far short of it, knowing that they're going to be limited and constrained and likely lost unless you can go to the next step of structural or revolutionary reform. But you need to have the type of committed organization and cadre, you know, that is willing to put the effort into trying to do that.
On the issue of trade unions and why they're so weak today, I think there's an imagination of wanting to have a kind of return to class politics, given the financial crisis. But financial crises aren't necessarily the best time for organizing for unions. And also unions have, you know, really been shrinking for decades. How should a new left orient towards organized labor? I mean, is it just an issue of people on the ground, historical defeats, or is there like a deeper structural problem that's really not being confronted?
They're very deep structural reasons. Some of them are demographic. Some of them have to do with the dynamic development of capitalism and the transformation of labor processes and labor markets. Some of them have to do with deep structural factors associated with trade unionism. And then some of them have to do with more personal or generational failings. So if you started with the first one, I think it's been quite remarkable that whereas trade union leaders in the great historical phases of the building of socialist movements, from the Wobblies to the Marxist-Leninist parties, even to the Social Democratic Party, were prepared to risk their reputation and legitimacy with the workers who had come to trust them as trade union leaders to win them more, to win them protections from their employer, etc. They were willing to risk that by coming out as socialists, as communists, as revolutionaries, and to try to bring them along. It was that led Marx and Engels to think that unions could be schools for socialism. Not that trade unions themselves were going to engage in revolutionary behavior, but that insofar as a cadre in the labor movement, which is the way, you know, What Is to Be Done was written. It was precisely out of that kind of thinking that Lenin was writing that through union struggles in the 1890s in Russia. You know, that a cadre could be courageous enough to do that. And what has been remarkable about my generation of trade union leaders, this applies as much to women in the movement as to men, socialist feminists as to the men in the movement, is I don't think they've had the courage to do that. It takes a lot of courage, and it's very risky, because people say, I didn't know the trade unions didn't make a revolution. And, moreover, you need to be able to do that while not engaging in the type of ultra-left behavior that leads you to engage in strikes that are about a revolution rather than actually winning people something in the concrete way that an employer can actually give you. So there's been that failure, and that needs to be figured out in terms of that generation of union leaders as opposed to the earlier ones. The deeper structural ones also need to be examined, and I think obvious ones have to do with the decline of industrial organizations of the old type, the much more flexibilized labor markets, the enormous growth of the service sector. In those kinds of conditions, it's harder to organize unions. There's a greater turnover of membership, the units are smaller, all that kind of stuff, which one knows very well. But that's a real structural factor. But there's also a structural factor that has to do with trade unionism or with working class organization, which also comes up in parties, but it's not as I think, deeply embedded. And that is the tendency to bureaucracy in working class organizations. What a great book written during the First World War called The Iron Law of Oligarchy by Roberto Michel is really analyzed. And it's essentially this. You have people who are on a shop floor or in an office. They're part of a collective of workers. They are the spark plugs in for whatever reason, their toilet training, whatever reason, they happen to be the type of people who organize other people, are willing to take, have the gift of the gab and are willing to take the risk of doing this. And they organize other people. And you get the formation of a trade union. Or if there's already one, they create a new local to become activists in it. They leave the office or the shop floor and they become full-time functionaries. That's not because they're bad people. It's because doing this is not a picnic and it's hard to do it in the evenings after work. You need people who are dedicated full-time to taking on this incredibly powerful set of capitalists, right, that you're working for, all the supports they've got. So people become paid full-time out of the membership dues of the union. Those few who are employed full-time control the union funds, control the decision about when the next convention is going to be held, control whatever means of communication that the organization produces. Right? And inevitably, I think there's a structural barrier that is not impossible to overcome, but that does arise. And that is that those people will, to some extent, use those resources not to go back to the shop floor. They don't want to go back to the mind phase. They're not working in an office. And they're interacting more and more on a day-to-day basis with journalists, with bosses, and find that they don't eat babies for breakfast. You know, that these are people who are not evil. They're also subject to structural constraints of competition, et cetera, et cetera. And that begins to change them. At the same time, the people who elected them, the people who that they came out of, are very deferential towards them. You finally have somebody that's standing up for you. You know, in this bloody world where, you know, you've been kept down all your life, and here's someone who's speaking up for you. So the tendency on the part of the masses of the organization is to be very oriented to giving these people a lot of rope, a lot of space. This has been a tremendous structural problem in labor organizations. It's been something that the labor organizations themselves and too few Marxist theorists have addressed themselves to. Lukács, at the end of History and Class Consciousness, a book that's very problematic in many ways for its teleology, as you were alluding to, says that the greatest problem of the working class movement is the problem of organization, and it's been hardly theorized in the Marxist canon. And he was absolutely right. Michels wasn't a Marxist, he was a social democrat, he ended up a fascist, ended up supporting Mussolini in Italy. But he theorized this. Only Bukharin took it seriously and said this is something we really need to look at in the Bolshevik movement. The rest of them swept it under the table. Oh, anybody who says this is not taken seriously. This is also a structural problem. So it's not only the structural problem of capitalist labor markets, it's also the structural problem of working class organization, you know, that needs to be addressed in terms of understanding this. And it's something that, you know, the best Marxist minds need to address themselves to, as well as the best organizers.
I wanted to maybe back up just a little bit. You were in the USSR before the collapse, and you met with trade unions, it's in your book. And there was quite a bit of trade union activity going on at that time, and this is the more famous things in Poland. But I think something good definitely happened on the level of sort of social imagination and getting beyond the bad legacies of communism. But in that part of the world, it's been a sort of economic disaster, really. How are we to deal with that contradiction, I guess? Because the collapse of communism has not been a good thing for those people in many ways. And there's many conflicts that have been born out about that. Afghanistan is one such example. But at the same time, there is something of an opportunity that's being opened up.
I was first in the Soviet Union as a graduate student when I was at the LSE in 1970. I went on a National Union of Students tour of Moscow, Leningrad, and Kiev. And I visited the History of the Revolution Museum, which is in an old gentleman's club, the Englishman's Club, or what used to be. Sure, it's not there anymore, in Moscow. And it was, until you got to 1917, it was the most remarkable collection of peasant and working class political artifacts you could find anywhere in the world. The investment that had gone into creating an archive, a living archive, was tremendous, of struggles, was astonishing. And then as soon as you got to 1917, the falsification began. There was a photo of the Petrograd Soviet, and Trotsky wasn't in it. And I wasn't a Trotskyist, but you didn't have to know much to know that Trotsky was rather active in the Petrograd Soviet. So I said to this young history student who was doing the guided tour, "Where's Trotsky?" And she said, "Well, he wasn't in the Petrograd Soviet." And I don't know to this day whether this history student didn't know this, which is conceivable, or whether she was lying. That had an indelible effect on me, I have to say. I mean, I already was suspicious, but it had an indelible effect. When I was there in 1990, just before Gorbachev was overthrown, we spent a lot of time visiting trade unions, and there was an independent trade union movement, as well as activists in the official trade union movement, which of course was a cipher of the party, or usually of enterprise management. which was trying to democratize those things. And it was very interesting to talk to those people because they would take you around and show you that there were legacies of the Soviets that were still there at the local level in the trade union movement. You know, there were meetings around the allocation of work time, which were especially important to women in terms of the double day, in terms of who bears children, who doesn't, etc. That really were quite remarkable on the shop floor. And you could see that, and these people would proudly show you this, even though in every other respect the unions were ciphers of management. There was an incredible resentment on the part of these trade unionists of the Communist Party and of Gorbachev, even though he was opening it up. One of them said to us, "We were made fools of." And he didn't mean by that they had been fooled. He meant that they were actively turned into fools by the type of bullshit ideology and empty rhetoric that the union had carried out, he said, since 1926. There was a tremendous spirit of we want workers' control. But that was understood in terms of bullshit Western models of profit sharing. And there was a romanticization of the market, which was remarkable. So a lot of them would define themselves as market socialists. But what they meant by that was that their enterprises should be run by the workers, but profit-making. Those workers ought to keep those profits, and you know, to hell with any other workers down the road. And just an unbelievable naivete about how that would play itself out. And of course, how it played itself out, why all these billionaires have emerged out of this process, is that in fact, Gorbachev was planning and Yeltsin did pass out effective coupons that would give workers control over the means of production, which were saleable. And you know, workers sold them to effectively the managers or more often the children of the local Soviet elite. And they ended up therefore owning the means of production, all of the incredibly rich resources of Russia. So you could see this naivete operating. I mean, when they would ask for what's going on in the West that should be interesting to us, they didn't want to hear about struggles to democratize the labor movement here. They didn't want to hear about strategies to build a new socialist type of politics. They wanted to hear about profit sharing. And a lot of harm was done by those naive leftists who throw out that type of workers' management, market socialism type of stuff. That's what I most strongly felt at that time. And yes, I think that that working class has suffered enormously. The result of it politically has not been very good. A lot of those workers in a place like Hungary are now crypto-fascists. And what remains of the old Communist Party, if you go read it online in Russia, is a Stalinist nationalism, a Russian nationalism of a kind that was always there in Stalinism, but is now full blown. Those who, in a sense, regret the change have not managed to build an alternative that is very positive.